Hello and good evening. My name is Thorin Tritter. I'm the Museum and Programming Director at the Holocaust Memorial and Tolerance Center located in Glen Cove, New York. I'm delighted to welcome you to tonight's screening and discussion about Viva La Causa, the story of a great movement for social justice led by Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta. This is one of two programs that the Holocaust Memorial and Tolerance Center has held to honor National Hispanic Heritage Month, and I'd like to thank our co-sponsors who've helped spread the word about these programs, the Nassau County Office of Hispanic Affairs, the NAACP's branch in Freeport Roosevelt, and La Fuerza Unida based in Glen Cove. I'd also like to put in a special word of thanks to Bill Taub, who's working behind the scenes to make our film come out smoothly this evening. Thanks very much. Let me also add one other technical item. I think that in order to have the film shown in the broadest possible full part of your screen, you may need to go to the top of your screen where I believe it says in green you're viewing Bill Taub's screen, and next to it there's a button that says View Options. And if you click on the down caret where it says View Options, and then click the side-by-side mode so that the side-by-side mode is off, then hopefully my face will appear at the top of your screen rather than at the side, and you'll have the full image of the movie. So at the top, View Options, you click it and then click on the side-by-side mode to turn that off. Okay, hopefully that'll help you. You may be wondering why the Holocaust Memorial and Tolerance Center would be holding a program about Cesar Chavez and the struggle against the struggle for migrant workers in the 1970s. And the answer is really quite simple. We are a Holocaust memorial, but as our name tries to also make clear, we are a tolerance center. Our mission is not only to teach about the history of the Holocaust, but also to teach about the dangers of racism, bullying, and all manifestations of intolerance. Our mission is also to promote resistance to prejudice and advocate respect for every human being. So showing a film about migrant workers and the struggle against discrimination is something that fits right in our wheelhouse. I will also say that HMTC is eager to celebrate events, films, and speakers that empower people to stand up against oppression and to stand up when they witness persecution. One of the major lessons that we embrace is the need for people not to be bystanders. And when they see misdeeds, when people see misdeeds, to encourage those people who see misdeeds to stand up and be upstanders, as we call them. I'll say more about that word in just a minute when I introduce the woman behind tonight's screening. But before then, let me put in a plug for some of our other upcoming virtual programs. Next Wednesday, October 14th at 11 a.m., we're going to be holding our regular virtual museum tour of the Holocaust Memorials Museum. This one's going to focus in particular on the experiences of children during the Holocaust. And I should add that we will be reopening our doors at the Holocaust Memorial and Tolerance Center for in-person self-guided visits on October 15th, but by appointment only. So please check on our website and email us if you're interested in coming to see the museum in person, but we're still going to hold our virtual tour on October 14th. Then Monday the 19th at 11 a.m., we're having our outdoor yoga in Wellwind Preserve. That's not virtual yoga, that's in-person yoga, but outside and socially safe distanced. And then finally, one more program to mention on Tuesday, October 20th. Please join me for a discussion with historian David Nassau about his new book, The Last Million, Europe's Displaced Persons from the World War to Cold War, which explores what happened to the 1 million Holocaust survivors, former slave laborers, and POWs who found themselves in Germany at the end of World War II. The book is receiving some really great reviews, and I hope you'll be interested to hear the author talk about this topic and his research. Okay, so now on to tonight's program. I'm just gonna click a few buttons here. And hopefully get our, there we go, excellent. To introduce our program and our speaker tonight, I'm gonna call on Marae Taub, the woman behind all of the Holocaust Memorial Center's, Tolerance Center's film programs. Murray is a Holocaust survivor who's been volunteering as an educator and docent at the Holocaust Memorial and Tolerance Center for many years. In addition to her work with school groups and serving on our Education Advisory Committee, in 2013, she launched the David Taub Real Upstanders film series in honor of her late husband, who was also a survivor of the Holocaust. To date, Murray has helped bring more than 20 film programs to our calendar, all of which have been connected to the idea I mentioned a few moments ago and the need to fight against the urge to simply be a bystander and instead encourage us all to be upstanders. And our program today and the film we're showing today fits on that same topic and builds on that same approach. So Murray, thank you so much for all you do for the Holocaust Memorial and Tolerance Center. And I pass the baton to you for your introductions of our program tonight.
Thank you everyone for watching and participating in our Watch From Home new film format in the David Taub Real Upstanders film series. The David Taub Real Upstanders film series is named after my husband, David Taub, who was a hidden child in a small village in the heart of France during the Second World War. He desperately needed upstanders in his life and was fortunate enough to have found some, but not necessarily in the conventional sense of the word. His foster family treated him as family and sometimes harshly because of that and as well as the mores of that time period. Backbreaking labor before, after school, all seasons, all weather, no exception, was very different from his urban Paris life and therefore very challenging. If he were to survive the war, he vowed, never farm life, in spite of having been written into grandma's will. On a personal note, my father was an illegal migrant from Poland into France, working as a farm worker in Brittany in the early 20s. He too made himself the same promise. And as soon as he managed to learn French and save enough money, he returned to big city life in Paris. Our film this evening deals with the conditions of migrant farm labor in California in the late 60s. Life was harsh and brutal. This is a story of accommodation, resistance, acceptance, and integration. I would like to introduce our facilitator, Nelson Melgar, head of the Constituent Liaison Group to the New York State Democratic Assembly. Born in the Honduras, he emigrated with his mother and has become a community activist, a DACA recipient, and the voice for the new and about to become new citizens of Nassau County. As we watch this watershed moment in our history, I would like all of us to think about the following. We on Long Island have so much to consider as we watch this watershed time in our past, and among those concerns are the similarities and differences between then and now, California and Long Island. Nelson, would you like to say hello?
Hi everyone, can you all, well, I can't get a response, I suppose. I hope you all hear me just fine. And thank you for that warm introduction. And thank you to everyone for joining us tonight as we celebrate the accomplishments of Cesar Chavez, an American civil rights icon and a hero to farm workers all over the country. Before I start, I'd like to direct your attention to the message that I just sent. I hope all the panelists and all the attendees, as you watch the film, naturally, you'll probably have some questions. And if I have the answers to your questions, I will gladly answer your questions. If I don't have the answer, then I will research the subject and you can always provide me with your email address and I will reach out to you with an answer. That said, again, Cesar Chavez is an American icon and he really is a hero to farm workers everywhere in the country. But the important thing to know before we watch the film is that what he was doing when he started the strike, what he was doing as he led this strike for a period of 5 years or so, is he was responding to something from the FDR era. See, when President FDR decided to, you know, do something about the economy, do something about the Great Depression. One of the key packages of his New Deal was a particular act that gave workers all over the country the right to collective bargaining. However, in order to acquiesce and in order to allow for the bill to pass the Congress, he compromised. And that compromise was that he left out farm workers from that particular act. And by leaving out farm workers, he created a condition where farm workers had essentially no recourse to exercise, rather to seek for some enforcement of their rights. And this persisted for decades after FDR, until Cesar Chavez had enough. And in a world full, abundant with bystanders, he was an upstander, and he did something about it. And he mobilized an entire community that needed a voice, a leader that desperately needed somebody to stand up for them. And he mobilized them, and he created real perpetual change. But the change that he created was a change that started in California and slowly and gradually moved across the country, but did not reach every part of the country in reasonable time. And one of those places is New York. As a matter of fact, the situation that Cesar Chavez dealt with 50 years ago, his cause, right? The struggle to obtain rights for farm workers was not something that was dealt with in New York until last year. And I want you to think about that for a second. For essentially 50 years after Cesar Chavez led a movement, New York farm workers were left in the dark. New York farm workers did not have collective rights, did not have the right to a decent wage, to overtime, did not have a right to a day off, to unemployment benefits, sick days, or anything of that sort. And it's only through tremendous work and organizing and lawsuits that, you know, that reality changed. And it only changed last year, but the battle continues. So as you watch the film, I want you to think about the hurdles that farm workers face when they confront their employers. What are the consequences to a farm worker who's trying to exercise, who's trying to enforce their rights? What are the consequences to the employer? I want you to think about the resolve that is necessary to sustain a strike for a prolonged period of time, the resources that are needed for that to happen. And I want you to think about what avenues are available to a farm worker who's trying to have his rights enforced. What avenues are available to him or her to be able to do that? I really do hope you enjoyed the film. Thank you all very much for being here with us. And again, please, if you have any questions, do not hesitate to ask. Thank you.
On a summer evening in 1965, hundreds of impoverished campesinos, Mexican-American farm workers, packed into a church hall.
You're here to discuss a matter of extreme importance to yourselves, your families, and all the community.
People had enough, they were ready to do something. Everybody was sick and tired of the conditions, the hard work, the low pay. It was very close to slavery.
The question, whether to join a strike started days earlier by a Filipino union against the powerful grape growers in the San Joaquin Valley.
They didn't care about the workers, they didn't care about the people, they didn't respect us.
This is a struggle for freedom and dignity, which the poverty we live in denies us.
They united behind one of their own.
The growers have used violence against the Filipinos, but we must not retaliate with violence.
Cesar Chavez had no money. He had no politicians in his hip pocket. All he had was his indomitable will.
Tonight, we must decide if we will join our fellow workers in this great struggle.
The only way that things were going to change was if we all got together, all in one voice. We had to do it together.
Do we strike?
When we took that vote, it was unanimous. Everybody voted to strike.
Viva La Causa!
Viva!
Viva La Justicia!
Viva!
Give us our justice. You know who I'm talking to.
Give us our justice.
Things that I see, brothers and sisters, come on, break free.
Justice, give us a justice.
You know who I'm talking to.
Give us a justice.
Welcome, welcome.
Start fighting. Right here in the field.
Don't be a slave anymore.
In Spanish, it's la huelga, the strike. In reality, it was much more.
Viva la huelga en el fin. Viva la causa en la historia. La raza llena de gloria. La victoria va a cumplir.
When you look at the struggle of the farm workers, it's really a human rights movement, is what it is. Because they were fighting for their basic human rights that they did not have. And they were not being treated as if they were human beings.
And the foreman would push us. You have to do hurry, 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 hurry. You gotta hurry, hurry.
We had no bathrooms, and it was embarrassing for the women.
We try to find a bush or something, and if not, then someone would take a blanket and kind of hold it in front of the woman. But it was extremely humiliating. If you had 40 people in the crew, they all had to drink out of one soda can.
My mouth would just, I could feel the germs crawling through my mouth.
Fields were sprayed with toxic pesticides.
We know that they were spraying around us, they were spraying on us, but we didn't know what was going on, what kind of a spray it was, well, what was it for. Nobody told us anything. And, you know, people would get sick.
Trapped in poverty, children often worked the fields with their parents.
I remember going into one field where they were picking tomatoes, and this little child's hands was smaller than the tomato that he was picking.
Workers earned about $1 an hour. They had no health benefits.
These workers were working very, very hard, but they were not being paid what they should have been paid so that they could properly feed their own children or clothe their own children and live in decent housing.
I don't think any of these places really speak of prosperity or security of any sort. Thousands and thousands of people are living like this, and they're farm workers.
The people who pick all of our food that we benefit from, that we eat, that comes to our table, don't have enough food for themselves every night. Their children go to bed hungry, and they ruin their lives giving us food.
Government did little to help. Farm workers had no right to organize. They were not covered by state and federal laws that protected other workers.
Migrant farm workers are the lowest on the totem pole in California in terms of any rights whatsoever. They had no say. They were completely powerless.
The power was held by the growers. Since the early 20th century, They built their riches on the backbreaking labor of a succession of underpaid and mistreated migrant workers. Chinese, blacks, poor whites, Japanese, and Filipinos. By the late 1940s, the majority of the state's farm workers were Mexican. One of them was Cesar Chavez, an American of Mexican descent.
Cesar was a very soft-spoken person, very little formal education, and yet he was so smart. He understood human nature.
At Cesar's side was his wife Helen and former school teacher Dolores Huerta.
It's hard to think of Cesar without thinking of Dolores, because in some ways they're counterparts.
The two met in 1956 while working with legendary organizer Fred Ross in the Community Service Organization. In 1962, Cesar set out to form the NFWA, the National Farm Workers Association. Dolores soon joined him.
Cesar started knocking on doors, and he would introduce himself. That's the way he came to my house, and he would explain to us his plan about doing something for the farm workers.
It became known as La Causa, the struggle to bring dignity and justice to farm workers.
I am Marcos Muñoz. I don't read or write, but not because I don't read and write, I'm gonna think that I'm last to you. No, I'm equal to you. You understand? I got a pound and a half brains here too.
By 1965, 1,200 farm workers had joined. Then the Filipino farm workers walked out of the fields.
It was too soon as far as Cesar was concerned. The organization wasn't strong enough. They didn't have enough money. But I mean, like, what can you do? There it was right in front of your face.
And for the first time in the history, the Filipinos and the Mexicans were together fighting for the same cause. And you know, huelga in Filipino is also the same as in Spanish. Huelga means strike.
Huelga! Huelga! Huelga!
The day after the strike vote, campesinos joined their Filipino brothers on the picket lines. In spite of the strike, grapes continue to be picked.
In any agricultural strike, there's always a surplus of poor people that need work that will come and scab, in effect. And it's just an economic reality.
They would bring buses with Mexicans and buses with people to break the strikes.
You're seeing the suffering all over. You're seeing the sickness.
On the picket lines, strikers urge scabs to walk off the job and join the strike.
We would just go out there and yell and scream, come on, brother, join us. Be with us. We need to unite. We need to be one. We need to fight for better conditions. Look at the growers. They don't care.
Where are your brothers and sisters over here? Come on. Come on now.
Growers tried to silence the strikers.
All the foremen or supervisors would come in and put their loudspeakers on and the radio real loud so that the workers that were inside working wouldn't hear us.
At the same time, they would be spraying dust on all of the pickets. They did everything that they could because they knew that once those workers heard our message, that they would come out and actually join the strike.
Viva la causa! Viva! 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 Viva!
When we get a crew to walk out, it was just like we celebrated. We shouted and we cheered and we hugged the people like brothers.
The celebrations, however, were fleeting.
We would pull some people out, and then 2 days later, here's another crew. So where did this one come from? You know, here we go again. So we had, like, start all over again.
And there was often danger.
So being pushed around, being knocked down, being threatened with guns. It was very intimidating, very, very, very scary.
And they would bring out their rifles and just level them at you when you were out there.
I remember that happening a couple of times where, you know, the bullets would come flying and you could hear them going, ping, you know, being going by.
We had police there that didn't even respond to our calls. They would not help us. They were helping the growers. We were the troublemakers, as they called us. We were the enemy.
We were angry. People were angry, you know. There were times when you wanted to strike back, but every day Caesar would tell us that this is a nonviolent strike.
Violence is not a way to victory.
We don't want violence at all. We don't believe in it. Not one of us believe in it.
There's moral power in nonviolence. King was using nonviolence in the South, and Caesar was aware of that. Nonviolence forces people to think about how to be creative when in dealing with injustice.
He admired Gandhi, he read a lot about Gandhi, and how Gandhi used nonviolence to bring about change.
Caesar knew the change farm workers sought could not be won alone. He called for public support.
After the word got out that the strikers needed help, young people began to flock to Delano.
I thought there would be dormitories like there was a university. I came in my little dress and I had a little suitcase.
Organized labor came.
My union will pledge $5,000 a month to these workers for as long as it takes to win their strike.
As did civil rights activists and clergy.
It became like this beautiful thing for them, this opportunity to do with their lives what they believed all along. And here were the poorest of the poor coming to them and asking them for that kind of help. And boy, did people respond, I'm telling you.
But growers and many Delano residents were hostile.
Why are you here today?
Because I don't like the people that are here in our town. They don't belong here, and I wish they'd all go back to where they came from.
People that are agitating these people have no concept of the produce business.
We had policemen against us. The whole system, it was pretty much against us, you know?
The local courts tried to stop strikers from picketing. The number of strikers at any one field was limited. Strikers were forbidden from wearing t-shirts with the union logo. They were even banned from yelling huelga or strike on the picket line.
Those are stupid injunctions, so of course we're going to break them. Civil disobedience, you know? So they could take us to jail. Men, women, and children, everybody in jail.
Hundreds were arrested. Farm workers, students, priests, and nuns. The courts effectively kept pickets away from strikebreakers who continued to pick the harvest.
Could never win the strike because there's always strikebreakers.
Our tactics are nonviolent.
We knew it wasn't working. And you know, the key to organizing is if it doesn't work, try something else.
Inspired by the successful Montgomery, Alabama bus boycott, led by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., the farm workers started their own boycott. Shenley Industries owned just a few vineyards, but their primary product was a perfect boycott target. Farm workers were sent to 13 cities. Their goal? Convince consumers not to buy Shenley liquor.
It was something that was people-based because we had all these strikers and these volunteers, and these are the people that could go out there and ask the American public to support us.
The boycott caught the attention of the United States Senate. A Senate subcommittee came to Delano to investigate. One of its members was New York Senator Robert F. Kennedy. Disturbed by the unwarranted arrest of farm workers, Kennedy confronted Delano officials.
How can you go arrest somebody if they haven't violated the law?
They're ready to violate the law. In other words,
but I suggest in the interim period of time, in the luncheon period of time, that the sheriff and the district attorney read the Constitution of the United States.
Caesar and Dolores testified before the committee. And at Dolores' request, so did Carolina Franco.
And I said to Dolores, but I'm not important, it's just me. She says, Carolina, you've been with us from day one. I said, we're farm workers, we just want better conditions in the fields. We don't even have water. We don't have no laws to protect us. And I said, we need your help. We need you to help us get laws in California. And I said,
Thank you so much for being here.
It's a basic question of hope for the future. And that's what this committee is dedicated to try to do something about. We're going to try to improve not just your lives, but more importantly, the lives of your children.
Well, you know, when somebody like Bobby Kennedy comes to visit, it puts you on the map. And I think Kennedy's presence there helped focus national media on what was going on.
Caesar had another idea to grab the country's attention. A protest march from Delano to the California Capitol.
Walking to Sacramento? That's over, what, 300 miles? Walking, we looked at each other and says, this guy is crazy.
On March 17, 1966, about 70 farm workers and volunteers started their pilgrimage up California's Central Valley.
We all marched right through the middle of town, screaming and yelling, Viva la huelga, Viva Cesar, Viva la Virgen. And oh, we were just yelling at everybody. We're standing by the windows and doors looking at us go right by the middle of town.
There we were with our huelga flags, flapping in the breeze. Here are these semi-trucks breezing past us. And there we are. We're marching. We're holding our own.
The first night, people, boom, developed blisters and soreness.
Oh, God, I was so tired. I wasn't used to walking.
Caesar sprained his ankle.
We even told him, you know, Caesar, you got to get off that foot. You don't have to march, you know. We don't need you. But he said, no, I got to march. And he didn't want to let us down.
So he became a walking, living symbol of the suffering of all of us.
We sacrificed to make change work for us, to make the growers change and make laws in Sacramento, to make the newspapers know what we were fighting for.
Tired yet determined marchers weaved a path off the main highway and through small farming towns. At every stop, new farm workers signed up for the union. The number of marchers swelled from hundreds to thousands. El Teatro Campesino, a farm worker theater group founded by Luis Valdez, led rallies every night.
Viva the United States of America!
We would set it up so that the union leaders, Dolores and Caesar and the others, would come up and give speeches, and then we'd lead the campesinos in music. We made people laugh.
We still claim that there are reds and agitators. Hold on. Among you Mexicans.
So it was a full evening every night.
Every day the media covering the march talked about the Shenley boycott. 18 days into the pilgrimage, Shenley had enough and agreed to formally recognize the NFWA.
What was the reaction when you made the announcement a little while ago about Shenley Industries agreeing to negotiate with you?
Oh, well, the reaction of the people was tremendous. I mean, they all feel very victorious.
Viva la causa! Viva!
It took 25 days, but on Easter Sunday, the pilgrimage reached Sacramento. A march that started with 70 people now numbered 10,000.
We thank and praise God for having us here today. Many people have helped us, and we welcome the help of the civil rights movement and of the students and of all those people who have helped us with our struggle. To all of the strikers in Delano, for their courage and for their determination to make this strike a success.
It was a very glorious day because at least I knew then that I was not alone. We were going to make changes.
We transformed that valley from a scene of oppression and depression and exploitation into a place of liberation. That's what the March to Sacramento did for us. And we did that on the simple human strength of being able to walk 20 miles at a gallop.
We shall not be more just like a tree that
are standing by the water. We are not being moved.
The euphoria of the pilgrimage slowly faded as the strike dragged into its second year. The NFWA merged with the Filipino Union to form the United Farm Workers Organizing Committee. Several Delano growers signed agreements with the union. Yet by the end of 1967, most still refused to negotiate. The movement again turned to its most effective weapon, the boycott. This one was directed at Jimara Vineyards, the world's largest producer of table grapes. Farm workers fanned out across the country.
We wanted to get people not to buy the grapes. The bottom line was, don't buy the grapes.
Jamar responded by borrowing other growers' labels and using them in place of their own. So the union expanded its boycott to include all table grapes farmed in California.
You got a multi-million dollar industry versus a bunch of guys who say they can stage a boycott and a strike and win.
The national boycott started slowly, and back in Delano, the strike was going nowhere.
We had been picketing for 2 years and we weren't winning.
So there was a level of frustration that built up.
Strikers continued to be targeted.
The growers were outwardly intimidating and threatening. So it becomes a question of just normal human reaction that some of the strikers would want to strike back.
Got to the point where people were talking about actually breaking arms or legs and burning up shades.
And a lot of people did want to resort to violence and thought, you know, taking up arms was the way to do it.
And some water pumps were burned. There was a Jamara packing shed that was burned.
Caesar knew that he had to do something, and he couldn't just tell the people. He had to lead by example.
Caesar took refuge at 40 Acres, an old labor camp that had been converted to the new union headquarters. He secluded himself in a small room and started a fast for nonviolence.
Fasting has a long religious tradition of making a personal statement about what is important in life.
He says, I'd rather lose a strike than to start violence on our side. That would be totally wrong.
On the 13th day of the fast, a weakened Caesar was forced to appear in court to defend the union against charges brought by Jamara lawyers.
We had to support him, one on each side going in. He was unsteady on his feet.
Thousands of farm workers turned out to stand with Caesar.
When Caesar arrived, people knelt down. People who worked there did not know what to do, what was happening. We transformed the Kern County Courthouse into a cathedral.
Jamara attorneys demanded that the judge remove the farm workers.
The presiding judge said, you know, if I kick these farm workers out of here, that would just be another example of gringo justice.
The judge ordered a continuance, and Caesar returned to 40 Acres.
Now, the longer the fast went on, the doctors became very concerned about the effect it was having upon his physical composition. I mean, this is serious business. This is not child's play.
But the fast was getting results. New members joined the struggle. Talk of violence stopped.
I think Caesar saw that the message was getting through to people, and I think when he saw the organizing work that was going on, he knew he'd accomplished his goal.
On its 25th day, Caesar ended his fast. The event was marked by a public mass. More than 3,000 people attended. Robert Kennedy was there.
You come here as members of his union to honor him as your leader. I come here as American citizen to honor him for what he's done, not just for you, not just for this state, but for all of the United States of America.
We broke bread together, and we had these thousands of workers there in this park. And all of the workers started shouting, Kennedy for president, Kennedy for president.
1 week after leaving Delano, Kennedy announced his candidacy for president of the United States. Cesar, Dolores, and scores of farm workers joined the Kennedy campaign. They registered new voters and helped get out the vote. On June 5th, 1968, Kennedy won the California Democratic primary. Jubilant supporters packed into the Los Angeles Ambassador Hotel for a victory party.
Thank you very much. I want to thank Cesar Chavez, who was here a little earlier, and all of those Mexican-Americans who were such supporters of mine, and Dolores Huerta, who is an old friend of mine and has worked with the union, to thank her and tell her how much I appreciate her coming tonight.
Robert Kennedy was supposed to come with me, and we had a mariachi waiting for him, and all the farm workers that had been out there were waiting for him.
My thanks to all of you, and now it's on to Chicago, and let's win there. Thank you very
much. As we were coming down off of the podium, someone came and said, "No, Senator, come this way."
Senator, Senator, this way.
So they actually then took him into the kitchen.
We heard commotion, we heard noises, we heard screaming, and I said, "What's going on?" And then we heard over the loudspeaker that Robert Kennedy was shot.
If there's a doctor in the house, I want to see him right here. Everybody else, please.
Oh my God, no, not again. And we couldn't believe it.
Nosotros
I, like many others, felt that Robert Kennedy was really going to be a great president. He was going to be somebody that was really going to go out there and fight for the poor.
For us, it meant the loss of having someone in power that would have really helped the union to develop.
The movement mourned Kennedy's passing with the rest of the nation, but it didn't allow his death to hold it back. Instead, it redoubled its efforts to spread the farm worker's story. By 1969, organizers were in more than 40 cities.
Hi, I'm Rita.
Hi, I'm Jess.
My name's Carmen.
Joe Cerda.
Andrea Munoz.
Javier Cadena.
I'm Helen, and I boycotted in San Francisco.
Get your motor running. Head out on the highway.
My name is Lupe. I boycott San Francisco and Los Angeles.
New York City.
Salinas. Cleveland.
El Cerrito. Brooklyn.
Cincinnati, Ohio.
Vancouver, Canada.
Boston.
Detroit, Michigan.
Chicago.
Hartford, Connecticut.
Washington, D.C.
Los Angeles.
Berkeley.
San Francisco.
Rochester, Buffalo.
Stockton. Sacramento.
Vyasa, Long Island. Plainview and New York City.
I'm Jan, and I boycotted in San Francisco and Vancouver, Canada.
We had $100 to get to Vancouver, Canada. So there were 8 of us, and we drove up in 2 cars, and we rented hotel rooms for 1 person, and then we all slept on the floor.
They said, "You're gonna go to Kansas City, Kansas." I said, "Okay, where is that at?" We didn't know where we were going. We didn't know anything about that town. All we knew, we were supposed to get there and right away stop the grapes.
It's a miracle when you think about it. Most of them had never been out of California or out of the San Joaquin Valley. Most of them, all they had was the name of maybe a priest or the name of a labor leader. And so they would arrive and then they'd just make a phone call and say, "I'm here from Delano. I'm a Delano grape striker and we need help."
In every city, organizers distributed tens of thousands of leaflets. They spoke to church groups, labor unions, schools and women's groups, explaining the farm workers' plight and asking for help.
Help us pass our leaflets. Help us by picketing a store. Help us by reaching out to other people. These are all very simple things that people can do because we know that people in our country have really good hearts.
The response was overwhelming.
Church people came, labor people came, students came, professors, attorneys, doctors. Unbelievable. They gave up what they were doing because they wanted to help someone else.
And that brought together a coalition of people from all across the board. There were all kinds of people of all races and all classes that helped us on the boycott.
In cities large and small, an army of volunteers descended upon supermarkets that carried California grapes.
We just picketed every day, 7 days a week, 12, 13 hours a day.
We were just really reaching out to people that had no idea about the story of the Farm Workers Union or the struggle at all.
We tell them, you know, we're here from Delano, we're here boycotting grapes because the workers back in the fields are asking for better wages and working conditions.
We want to get your support today.
So you talk about child labor, you talk about the pesticides, you talk about worker rights, but the point was is that if we didn't reach consumers and talk to them, if we didn't persuade them to not buy the grapes, that we were never going to win.
The message was really, you can engage in a very small act here. You can refuse to eat a grape, you can refuse to buy grapes, that will have an impact.
Consumers were also asked not to shop at stores that carried California grapes.
When we had a store that we knew had a lot of business for that particular chain, then we would just concentrate on that one store. And we're not going to take the picket lines off until you take grapes off of the entire chain.
Although hurting financially, the growers refused to back down. They still had powerful friends.
Or the grape boycott. Well, I've classified that in the past on a number of public occasions as immoral, and I think it is.
Immoral. And what about the immorality of people being treated like farm implements or little boys and girls having to work in the hot sun and no toilets and nothing? That's immoral.
Boycotters kept up the relentless pressure on supermarkets. The numbers of volunteers on the picket lines multiplied.
All these networks around the country just began to grow and grow and grow and grow on this issue. It's not only happening here in Chicago, it's happening in Indianapolis, happening in Philadelphia, happening in New Orleans even, happening in Montreal, happening in California.
High school students joined the cause.
We went to the art department at our school and asked for some poster board and painted our signs, actually, and walked about a mile from our school down to where the supermarket was and just started picketing.
We started seeing more and more people cooperating with the boycott. Hey, it is working, you know, it's working.
In 1970, a Harris poll estimated that 17 million people had stopped buying grapes. Unsold grapes rotted on supermarket shelves and in cold storage rooms. Several chain stores stopped carrying California grapes. Growers estimated they had lost $25 million. Finally, one of them surrendered. In April 1970, a Coachella Valley grower signed an agreement with the union. Crates of his grapes, now stamped with the Black Eagle Union label, hit the markets.
And so then the message out there on the boycott was, only buy grapes from growers that have the union label, that have the Black Eagle.
Supermarkets quickly sold out of union grapes.
They would call us and say, how can we get more of the Black Eagle label grapes? Where can we get them?
And then the other growers realized that the only way that they were going to sell the grapes is to put that Black Eagle label on the grapes.
Oh, they were taking a big hit. So that's when they started saying, we need to talk.
The call came to Jerry Cohen from grower John G. Mara Jr. on the night of July 25th, 1970.
And he said, I want to meet you with a member of my family tonight.
Caesar and Jerry drove to meet their adversaries.
We thought, well, if there's enough pressure on him, there should be enough pressure on all 29 Delano growers. So we ought to hold out and make sure everybody is at that table.
John, hey Jerry.
The two sides met at 4 a.m. in a Delano motel.
And John Sr. basically said, we're ready to talk now.
Caesar said to Jamara, we're not going to settle just with you. I want you to get all the growers together.
It took just one day.
John Jamara just rounded them up and forced them into it. Our industry's at stake, he's saying. We got to solve this problem.
Finally, it was over. On the day the contracts were signed, farm workers didn't just witness history. They made it.
What we anticipate here is a new era in agriculture.
For the first time, you had the growers in Delano surrendering to the union. And the growers also learned a lesson that their workers are human beings, you know.
Oh, I was happy. We were happy. He said, we won.
We had gone through so much, and finally there was a victory.
Every time somebody signed the contract and passed it on to the next, we applied. Yeah, there was a lot of clapping going on that day.
Farm workers want a wage increase. Toilets and cold drinking water in the fields. Rest periods, pesticide controls, a medical plan, and the right to be represented by a union.
When those union contracts were signed in 1970, it was a triumph for working people all over the world. The exploitation of campesinos had been going on for centuries in the Americas. There had been many protests that had failed. This is one that worked, and it worked for very specific reasons. The times were right, the leadership was right, the tactics were right, the economic pressures brought to bear on agribusiness were right, and it transformed the society and the world around us.
Without the help of those millions upon millions of good people who believe, as we do, that nonviolence is the way to struggle, without that help, I'm sure that we wouldn't be here today.
In this country, unless you really fight for what you want, you'll never get it. If the cause is just and right, people will support you.
The one thing that Cesar always said is that if you don't give up, you will win. And all of this happened because the people took this situation into their own hands and decided, we have to change this.
The strikers and the people involved in the struggle sacrificed a lot. 95% of the strikers lost their homes and their cars. But I think that in losing those worldly possessions, they found themselves.
No matter how unempowered one feels, as a lot of us do, especially in this day and age, oh, I'm just one person, I can't make a change. If you come together and you commit to making a change and you have the commitment and the truth behind you, you can make a difference.
Viva la huelga!
Viva!
Viva la causa!
Viva!
Viva Cesar Chavez!
Viva!
Give us our justice. You know who I'm a talking
Give
to.
Give us our justice.
Brothers and sisters, come on, break free.
Justice, give us a justice.
You know who I'm talking
give
to.
Give us a justice.
We're brown and proud.
Puro Mexicano, ese.
Oye, es lo que digo. This is what I'm representing. Look at all la gente, not knowing that there's something better. You better start searching to realize and find your savior. Feel the flavor, the flowing is real now. The yerba buena try, gonna make you fly, gonna make you hot out through the night. Why, why must my people suffer? They are cold, they are hungry, and without the help from anybody. You call them foreigners.
Well, I hope everybody enjoyed the film, and I know that there's already one question out there, and I have a few to pose to Nelson as well. Others of you, if you have questions, please type them in the Q&A box, and we'll get Nelson to respond to them. Nelson, before I pose any questions or we read some of the questions out there, are there any remarks you want to lead off with, or should we just jump to the Q&A?
I think that it's important to note that the protection of workers is something that is not particularly covered by any one particular act or law, but rather by a set of acts and laws. So one of the things that we have to keep in mind is that when a certain victory is achieved, you know, when you obtain a particular, you know, enforcement of a particular right, right? For example, you know, the right to a minimum wage, that doesn't necessarily translate to a right to overtime pay. You know, various laws have affected the, you know, the workforce in various ways. And the one thing that is consistent throughout literally the last several decades of history is that farm workers have been, for the most part, excluded from some of these amendments, from some of the, you know, from some of the changes in the law. And they're only added later as an afterthought. So to empower them with the ability, you know, to strike, to unionize, right? It's something that is quite tremendous, because it gives them the opportunity to advocate for rights that, for some reason or another, you know, their legislators have seen, you know, fit to leave out. So I just wanted to you know, point that out, and I'll take any questions now anybody may have.
Okay. Well, I see a couple that let me pose to you, and I have a couple. One is, you started this evening by talking about the delay in New York, and why New York had, or that New York had only given some of these workers' rights to farm laborers last year. And one of the question comes in is, do you know why it took so long, or was there an earlier effort that got squashed, or really, why is it not until 2020 that this is going on in New York?
I think that a lot of it has to do with the communities that are affected. So for example, in California, right, and just to highlight the story of Cesar Chavez. Cesar Chavez was born in California. He was a US citizen. And as a result of that, he, you know, had what you would call a particular different experience than some of the people who are, you know, affected in areas like New York. The farm worker community of today is predominantly minority. And in fact, the farm worker community of New York is actually, you know, for the most part, immigrant. For the most part, they're, you know, immigrants who either don't have a handle of the English language, who, you know, are afraid of coming forward because they're afraid of deportation, or afraid of other, you know, some other, what you would call repercussion. And so for the community that, you know, that now mostly represents the farm worker community of New York, it's a number of fears that aggravate their conditions and that also prevent them from, you know, from coming forward and from taking the sort of actions that, you know, that Susan Chavez did. Now, naturally, the immigrant community of New York has not always been the, you know, the dominant, what you would call community, and, you know, with respect to farm work. But I think that the sentiment is still the same. For the most part, it's mostly been immigrants. And, you know, these immigrants don't feel like they have the particular power, the particular ability to, you know, create the change that, you know, that is necessary. And that is why it's important to note that while what Cesar Chavez started in California has expanded and has grown, it has not reached all corners of the country. And for, you know, for the most part, the work that was done here in New York was the work of a number of organizations here in New York who challenged that, you know, their exclusion from the New Deal, you know, and who challenged it in various ways by going to the courts and demonstrating how, you know, that law was inconsistent with, you know, with the Constitution of the City of New York, and by going to the legislature, you know, and you know, lobbying the representatives to change the law so as to, you know, make it the law of New York.
You know, I think you've touched partially on another question or response to another question that came in, which was about why did President Roosevelt exclude farm workers from the New Deal? And maybe one of the answers, or part of the answer, I think, is the fact that we're talking about immigrants who may not be voters, And so right. Not a constituency that a politician might be so concerned about versus the growers, the farm owners, who were a demographic that would vote and would be a political force. Maybe there are other explanations that you know, I don't know.
Yeah, so I actually looked into that, you know, because I, you know, when I learned of the New Deal in school, I learned of you know, this truly magnificent, you know, change in law. And it was, you know, overreaching. It was something that was just, you know, remarkable, right? And it's one of our, you know, it's one of our golden, what you would call pieces of history. You know, people look back to the New Deal and they think of this, you know, this grand thing. And so I thought it was curious that, you know, people like farm workers, and not just farm workers, by the way, there are other excluded classes like contractors, you know, house workers, just to name, you know, some that I'm aware of. I thought it was curious that they would be excluded from the New Deal. And what I learned is that in order for FDR to pass, you know, the particular act that provided, you know, these sort of, you know, this set of guarantees, right? He needed the support of a number of Southern legislators who had, you know, farm owning constituencies. And, you know, whose constituent, for the most part, employed, you know, African-Americans to work the farms. So for them, it was, you know, and you could say this is debatable, right? But, you know, it can be said that one of the reasons why farm workers were excluded from the New Deal is because the legislators whose support was needed did not want to empower Black farm workers with the ability to organize. And so in some ways, you could say that this is a holdover of the Jim Crow era. And, you know, and that's something that that really, you know, startled me, because we live in 2020, right? You know, we've gone through quite a bit. We learn of Jim Crow as something that was in the past, but it's really not. It's ingrained in a number of statutes, a number of laws, and one of them is, you know, the one that we're discussing right now. So I think that FDR probably could have done better, but I can also see why he would think, you know, why he would think it prudent to exclude protection for farm workers. He had a number of other legislative agenda items that he needed support for, and I, you know, there are, you know, you can make an argument one way or the other.
I think one of the other big categories of workers who were excluded from the New Deal were clothing manufacturers, the people working in sweatshops down on the Lower East Side, for example. And that continues to be a challenge. I know that clothing manufacturers in New York today may well be unionized, but there are real challenges facing those employers too. Let me jump to some other questions that have been coming up. One is, and this is a slightly different topic, but, you know, we often think, or we can think, that the problems in society, like low wages or racism, these are problems that are so massive that it's impossible for any one individual to do anything to change. And I know, though, that you have worked to inspire political activism. And so I'm wondering, you know, we saw in this film an example of Cesar Chavez really rallying these people who didn't think they had a shot at changing things, and he managed to get them changed. What are things that you do or that you've seen others do? How do we inspire political activism today at a time when people think that the problems in the country are too big to tackle?
By giving people a voice. It just starts with, it literally, you know, the series, right, revolves about, you know, around upstanders. And the fact of the matter is, to be an upstander is not an easy thing, because you are confronted with, you know, you are confronted with what you would call an opposite force. And, you know, and it takes you out of your comfort zone. And it puts you on the spot. And, you know, and it causes you, right, to be what you would call in a situation that, you know, you could think in your mind perhaps that you don't have to be, right? It could be somebody else's problem. But I think that each and every one of us have an innate, not only ability, but also an innate responsibility to do right by others, to do right by those who are less fortunate. And I have to tell you, it can be your help, whatever that may be, can be of such consequence to somebody else who is in need. And so I've seen that play out in my life personally. I've seen that play out in the roles of others. I have met activists who, one day became fed up with the conditions of themselves or the conditions of others, and have just taken up and, gone to a legislator's office and begun having a conversation about the particular topic. And it's interesting because one of the things that we see now go around in social media is, the things that, Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg said, right? The various things she said throughout her life. And one of them, it's quite important, I think, to the conversation at hand. She said something like, lead, right? But lead in a way that others would follow you. I think that the message there is, if you get something started, others will join you. Oftentimes, being the first person to do something is, it's the hardest thing to do. And for me, that's the way it started. I became an activist because, as you may be aware, I'm a DACA recipient. And as a DACA recipient, up until recently, I wasn't eligible for any sort of financial aid for, my education. So there had been a bill in the New York legislature, that would grant DACA recipients and other dreamers, the ability, right, that the opportunity to attend a college, university, and to have some of the financial responsibility taken care of. And so Governor Cuomo came to Long Island on some other subject. He had just, I believe they had just killed DACA on, my apologies, the Dream Act and the legislature. And so I wanted to protest that, right? And he came, and then he canceled, the meeting that he was going to have in that place. So in the end, then the media began asking us, well, how do you feel about this? And there are people who just don't want to talk to the media. They want to put themselves out there because, as a DACA recipient, as someone who is, technically undocumented, when you talk to the media or you talk to a member of the government or you talk to anyone, you're putting yourself out there. You're basically telling them, look, here I am, come take me away. And so I had a moment, of truth. I thought, okay, I can just be quiet and say nothing, or I can stand up for myself, stand up for my, my siblings, stand up for my friends, my parents. I have been given a great gift, which is, I can speak English. And that is something that, not a lot of not a lot of immigrants, a lot of Latinos can do. And so I spoke and I became involved. And I think that sometimes, it's a question of doing what you have to do.
And I know you standing up, as you say, helped others to stand up with you. And I think often, and this is something we often talk about at the Holocaust Memorial, is, upstanding is a real challenge. But if you think of upstanding as building connections with other people who are going to stand with you, maybe it's not so isolating. Maybe it's not so scary if you realize that there are others out there who will stand with you. And that's exactly what we saw in the film as well, right? I mean, that long line of marchers doing 300 miles, those were people who were willing to join in, let alone the follow-up boycotts and things. So it starts with one, but it grows. I don't want to take too much longer because I know people have things to do this evening, but I did want to ask if you could say anything about the conditions of farm workers on Long Island. Long Island is an interesting place because it's got great wealth and suburban neighborhoods and wealthy enclaves, but also farms still, particularly out east. And so is this a big part of Long Island? Are there migrant workers on Long Island? Have the recent law that you talked about, has that changed things?
So, yes. Yes and yes. There are, there is actually a sizable, migrant workers community in Long Island. And there's a sizable migrant workers community in New York too. The law that changed, right? And it changed, between last year and this year, again, only empowers them to speak, to stand up for themselves. It doesn't, it doesn't automatically improve their conditions. This is, a work in progress. But the conditions that, created in them a need to stand up for themselves, right? And to create some sort of change were quite dire. You have, see, the situation with migrant workers and, and in particular farm workers, out east is that, A, they live in the farm where they work. And so they live in farm-owned property. And as a result of that, their ability to stay in safely in a particular place is contingent on their ability to continue to work. They, for the most part, are not individuals who have a strong handle of the English language. So they're not able to, voice their grievances. And as far as I understand, there have been situations where their, living conditions have been subpar, substandard, where you have individuals who are living in like makeup rooms, so to speak, that used to be a barn and now they just made a whole bunch of rooms in there, and that's just no way to live. I also understand that up until, at least this time around, they didn't have, the rights that most workers have. Again, the law just changed. They didn't have, the right, to unionize, for example. They didn't have the right, they were not provided their fair compensation for their work. They were deprived, overtime wages. And so what the law has created for them, the change in law has created for them is an opportunity for them to now air their grievances and base it in a statute, of law, where they can say, look, this is the law and it's wrong. And that is an ongoing battle. Right now, if I'm not mistaken, there is actually, pending litigation with respect to that. A worker is trying to obtain his fair compensation for the work done. And this is something that is going to continue playing out. And this is something as a consequence that is not going to go away. The victory that they've had is just the beginning. And the work will continue, and we got to become involved.
Thanks very much, Nelson. I know that you had mentioned earlier in the chat the organization. I just want to say it correctly: ruralmigrantministry.org. And I've also put up the websites and the email address for our partner organizations, La Fuerza Unida in Glen Cove, and also the Nassau County Office of Hispanic Affairs. Both of those have a range of services for people who want to get involved or want to try and, or need help in some way. So just, I pop those up there. And of course the NAACP's email address if people are looking to contact them. I would like to bring back Marae Taub, and let me see if I can get her back on the screen there, and try and pull our program to an end, because I know people have things to do. I don't know if Nelson, if you'd like to make, if there are other things that you were planning on saying, and then I'll pass the baton to Marae.
I just want to say thank you for the opportunity, and thank you for this engaging conversation. It's important that, we are cognizant, that we become cognizant of, of the need of farm workers, and that, and that we stand up for them, because they do the hardest type of work. And we all stand to benefit. We all benefit from their work. So the very least we can do is, to support them, in their struggle to secure their rights.
Thank you, Nelson. It was a very powerful movie. And as a personal takeaway, in paralleling our museum mission, is that I think we've all learned we can all make a personal change and affect a change. I want to thank everyone for attending the first in our Teaching Tolerance programs that is co-sponsored by the NAACP and the Nassau County Office of Hispanic Affairs. I hope you found this program interesting and relevant. I invite you to attend our next David Taub Real Upstanders program in the Teaching Tolerance series. As we prepare to go to the voting polls to exercise our civic voting duty, we will be showing Selma, A Bridge to the Ballot, on October 29th at 7:30. I can't think of anything more in the moment. We're looking forward to seeing all of you and seeing you soon. In the meanwhile, stay safe and stay well. Thank you again for attending.
Thanks very much, Murray. And thank you, Nelson, for your introduction and your comments and your insights. And once again, I'd also like to thank Bill Taub, who's been working behind the scenes to make the film come across so smoothly. I hope you all enjoyed it. I wish you all a very pleasant evening and look forward to seeing you at our next program and the next film, as Murray said, which is on October 29th about election or right before Election Day. I hope to see you all then. Have a lovely evening. Thanks very much.